It's 6:30, commencing the CRA Board meeting, call to order Tuesday, April 12th, 2016, at 6:30 p.m. at City Hall of Boynton Beach, Florida. Commissioner, Chair, Board Member Mac McCray is going to lead us in invocation, and I'll lead the Pledge of Allegiance.
Since we're getting it right, Vice Chair McCray.
Vice Chair, you got it.
Let us bow to the Creator and Maker of all mankind. Heavenly Father, we come before thee in the humblest manner that we know how. We first come recognizing that thou art the God above all gods. We ask that you bless our meeting. Most of all, you judge our decisions that we make. But most of all, let us be cognizant of the remarks of each and everyone that sits up here, as well as individuals from the public. In your name we pray. Amen. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Here.
Present.
Vice Chair McCray.
Here.
Mr. Katz.
Here.
Chairman
Graham. Here. All right. Agenda or approval. Any additions, deletions, corrections to the agenda?
Hearing none. Can I get a
motion to adopt the agenda?
Yes, please.
Okay, no problem.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Katz, you mind starting off?
Sure. I mentioned at a previous City Commission meeting, I met with the developers of the Riverwalk Complex. I also met with city staff a day ago, and I have a meeting with some members of some of the intercoastal groups tomorrow. That's it.
Chair, Vice Chair McCray.
Thank you, sir. The only disclosure that I have tonight is that I met with Stephen Worry and his group this morning at 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. here at City Hall. Thank you.
I also met with the developer and owner of the Riverwalk property, and also the owner and developer of the proposed RV park that's going to be going in. And I also have a meeting tomorrow with a representative Big tomorrow.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Just a few things that I knocked off my list. One of them being that I had my baby boy a couple of days ago, so I'm grateful to be here and one piece. Still, I did get a chance to sit in on the Big and the Riverwalk Plaza forum meeting that happened a couple of weeks ago. So that was very informative in terms of what the community is looking for. So we are hoping to see what the developer has to enlighten the community on that. And I've been in communication with several of the other developers for the projects that we have coming up. I will meet with them soon. That's all I have for now.
I have a few things in the CRA. I attended Arbor Day over at JC Park. And what I'd like to do is that if we, one of our board members that goes to any of the CRA restaurants or services, that we announce it so that they can get the credit of, you know, being a great place to go. I've been to the East Ocean Cafe, and I got my wonderful haircut over at Tipsy. Next thing, meeting with, and then I met with Tom McClure and Christine DeHasseth. I met with Israam Realty and their attorney, Steve Weary. And that's about it. All right.
Chair, I want to just let you know that I got a very encouraging call today regarding one of the top, if not the top, restauranter in Palm Beach County wanting to locate on Ocean Avenue. So looking at 211 East Ocean, so that's very encouraging. This is somebody that kind of was the front runner of the redevelopment of Delray, so stay tuned. I think that's very exciting news for our city, our downtown.
there any other informational announcements?
Vivian, can you disclose that name at this time?
They don't like that. Well, let's wait and see what gels. That's, you know, in the field of economic development, people like to stay quiet until they get close to a deal. So, but it's a good thing.
Any information you do gather, you'll be sharing with the board?
Yeah.
Right.
I will. They just want to get their rent and all that figured out. So.
I did want to mention something really quickly. I wanted to say thank you to the board and to the CRA staff for the beautiful array of flowers that I got yesterday. So thank you all so much for being so thoughtful and thinking of me during this time. Thank you.
Just before we moved on, since you made mention, Chair, that you went to Arbor's Day, I did Arbor's Day as well. Also did the topping off ceremony for Ridge Landing Apartments, and I attended this afternoon the Police Department Award Ceremony.
Okay, one more time. Is there any other informational items?
Nope, seeing none. We'll move on to, what is it, Section 7, Announcements and Awards, Music on the Rocks.
Good evening, Board. Christopher Burdick, CRA Special Events Coordinator. On Friday, March 18th, 2016, the Boynton Beach CRA presented Music on the Rocks featuring 6 Foot Swell. The free event took place at the Ocean Avenue Amphitheater from 5 to 9 p.m. We had approximately 500 guests that attended the concert and our food truck event. 6 food trucks were on site, provided by the Food Truck Invasion, which guarantees a rotation of the food trucks each month and markets the joint event. The bar is provided by Carefree Catering. We had free on-site parking. The next Music on the Rocks concert is a double billing scheduled for this Friday, April 15th, featuring the Intoxicators and Slip and the Spin Outs, playing Exotica, Rockabilly, Rock and Roll, R&B, Swing, Country, Blues, and Roots. The event starts at 5 p.m. and ends at 9 p.m. The two remaining Music on the Rocks dates are May 20th with Gravel Kings and June 17th, Red Eye Band. And for Movies in the Park, on April 1st, 2016, the Boynton Beach CRA hosted Movies in the Park at the Ocean Avenue Amphitheater. The featured movie was the original Ghostbusters. The free event took place at 8 p.m. and ran till 10. Guests were encouraged to bring beach chairs and blankets. We had extensive free parking. The trailer of select CRA district businesses was shown before the film. Gift cards donated by the selected CRA businesses and gift cards donated by the selected CRA district businesses and Pirate Fest souvenirs were given away to guests through a drawing after the movie. Food, snacks, and beverages were available for purchase from vendors on site. Our attendance for this movie was 167 people. The attendance the previous month, March 4th, for the showing of E.T. the Extraterrestrial was approximately 130 people. The next Movies in the Park feature is Labyrinth on May 6th. And the last movie in the park date for the season is June 3rd, featuring Beetlejuice. And then I have a recap of the second annual Boynton Beach Blarney Bash. On Friday, March 11th, 2016, the Boynton Beach CRA presented the second annual Boynton Beach Blarney Bash in celebration of St. Patrick's Day. This free event took place at the Ocean Avenue Amphitheater and along Ocean Avenue from 1st Street to the front of the Civic Center from 6 p.m. to 10 p.m. Entertainment included Fire in the Kitchen, Aaron Moore Dance Academy of Dance, Clockwork Knotwork, and Blues Dragon. Retail vendors lined up on Ocean Avenue along with children's activities and a super slide. A Wearing of the Green contest was held with prizes awarded for first, second, and third place winners. Food and drink was available for purchase from KP Concessions and Carefree Catering. Free on-site parking was available, and we had approximately 2,500 guests this year. Yes. It's an approximation, but yes, we do count the crowd.
How is that compared to last year?
It's about 500 people more. Thank you.
agenda? Is that-
agenda.
Second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No, we just include that for your information. If- Again, that was for your information. This is it. Yes, these are all information only.
Regarding the information that we received. Or discussions. Hearing none, we're going to open it up to public comments.
Good evening, commissioners, mayor. Linda Cross, 625 Castle Lima Boulevard, unit 601, Boynton Beach. I'm here today because I am the new chair of the CRA Advisory Board, and we've only had three meetings, but one of the things that has become very clear, I think, to all of us on the board is that, or on the advisory board, is that the process in Boynton Beach for development is really very confusing. Now we have another entity, the CRA Advisory Board, that you know, our charge is to, as representatives of the citizens of Boynton Beach, to make recommendations to the CRA board, to you all. Then your charge would be to make recommendations to the city commission, which is you all. So that's a little convoluted, and right now I don't think that that anybody really understands that process. And so far, you know, there are several things on this agenda that are new projects. Maybe they're not new, but they certainly are coming up for discussion, none of which have, no developers, nobody has come before the CRA Advisory Board to make any presentations, to meet with any of us, to do anything. So my point is that it's very confusing, I think, for both the citizenry and the developers having three different groups to have to deal with when there's development in this area. And the CRA area is an area of very much in need of redevelopment, development, and responsible development. And I really believe that it should be something that we can work together, but also the CRA Advisory Board needs to take a more, I'd say, an earlier role in these projects, so that if we're in a position, so that we are in a position to make recommendations, whether it be to the CRA board or directly to the city, I think the advisory board needs to be in a better position to do that. And right now we're sort of behind instead of ahead of the projects. So it's early. We've only had three meetings, and we've just learned where the money comes from, which is good. We learned what some of the projects are, and we learned what a CRA really can and can't do. So now that we've got all that background, we really need to, I think, push ahead and get the purpose of the CRA Advisory Board in front of the public and in front of the developer, so that we can get some good recommendations for the city. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments.
I may jump in here to the director. Vivian, is this something that we can now start getting these developers who want to develop in a CRA direct, like they do in the P&D board, come before our advisory board, listen to the project?
No. We had this discussion today with Ken Dodge, our attorney, and Tara Dewey. There is a development process right now that the city has. It's a legal process, and I'm going to let Ken take it from here because I'm not a lawyer, but the way it was explained to me today, it puts the city at legal risk to have an advisory board opining to this board that doesn't actually have any review of projects. You don't have legal review of projects. So, and the CRA board, advisory board, would be opining on a project to you that doesn't have any authority to, they don't report to the city commission. So, and So that was the upshot that I understand. I'm going to let Ken give you the legalese.
Yeah, I think there just needs to be a clear distinction between the CRA board, obviously, and the city commission. And that's an advisory board to the CRA, to this body. If the CRA board is not going to have any jurisdiction or review over a project, there would be no.
Well, let me ask you this. What's the difference between the plan, P&D board that we have, advisory board, that advises us, and why the CRA advisory board can't advise us? Is that basically what you're telling me? The advisory board cannot advise us?
It can advise this body, but it would be in some.
Getting a little confused here.
The fact that you're the same bond, the same group of people, we have to make sure that we are always remembering that you're two distinct bodies with two distinct functions.
Okay, let's simplify this. Can the CRA advisory board advise the CRA board? Okay.
Project so, within the purview and properly before the CRA
right.
board.
So can I finish, please? So what would be the difference if, why wouldn't they be able to listen to a developer's idea or plan and listen to that?
There may be times when the matter was going to come before the city commission at a properly noticed hearing that would be a public hearing, that where you may not want to have certain endpoint at, say, a CRA board, which is not, you know,
well, eventually it all ends up in front of the city commission. It's just a matter of how it gets
it's
there.
It's a legal process. What Ken's trying to tell you is that the development process is a legal process with steps, and the city has to perform the steps at a certain time certain.
Okay.
To insert new steps that aren't in the process would threaten the my understanding when we were discussing it this morning on our call, our Tuesday morning call, is that if the development was turned down, they could say, well, you inserted this additional process that isn't in the legal process that you have in your code. So the Planning and Development Board in your code is part of the process. The CRA board is not part of the review of a project. The only reason it's on there is for information, to let you know what it looks like. That's it. It's not there for you to review or opine on it. That's all it is. And it's not, you're not getting it, you're not getting a staff report from me or from Mike Rumpf's department. So that's all it is. And the risk, and Tara is going to be writing a memo along with Jim Cheroff, explaining the risk, the legal risk to the city, primarily the city, of doing that, that it really is a risk to the city. So that's why.
Let me ask you this question. Can I finish my question?
No, you're done.
I got more questions.
I'm sorry, but you're done. Okay? All right.
Now, this is public comments, and we're going to let the finish public comments. If we want to talk about the CRA advisory board, we'll do that later. Comment.
Thought I was confused when I got here. My name is Harry Woodworth. I live at 685 Northeast 15th Place in Boynton Beach, here representing the Inlet Cove Community Association, INCA. Last week we attended the CRA meeting that Linda spoke of, and just to see how it worked, and we had some issues with how the process was going with this Riverwalk project, and just wanted to see, you know, how this all worked. It was pretty obvious almost instantly that this thing is still a work in process. I understand that it's new, and that was kind of why we went there. But what we're missing, we came away with five questions because we don't have a clue how this thing's working. Apparently, we're not the only ones. First question was, what's the role of the advisory board? And apparently, you guys are going to work on that. Why wouldn't every project going through the CRA be reviewed by the CRA advisory board? I mean, I just don't get this. How does a project go around all of that, goes through the advisory board, goes over and gets a political decision from the commission, and nobody that's a citizen or the CRA that's running the CRA area gets to vote or review it? Don't get that. So maybe you could clarify that. Does the advisory board represent the community? Because I was here a few months ago when I think everybody in the community lined up for hours kind of asking for that, and this was set up for that. Now, don't know. So maybe we get a clarification on that. Does they represent the community on development projects within the CRA? This is kind of minor at this point. How do you contact the CRA advisory board members since there's no contact information whatsoever on the board? There's just their names. No phone numbers, no emails, so no way to get to them. And then I guess I did this a while ago, but who specifically does the advisory board advise? And I thought I was confused when I wrote this, and I'm standing here now. I don't have a clue. So maybe you guys could just answer this and let us know how it's going to go, because we got a, you know, some real big projects coming here. The Riverwalk project, I think we don't have to discuss here. We discussed it ad nauseum one night. We've got a developer who got up and said the city and the CRA came to him, alluded at the meeting 2 weeks ago that it was a done deal, and yet there's no one we can talk to, and no one seems to be listening. So we're a little frustrated with that. Ocean One's coming out of the ground. You know, who do we talk to on that? How do we get heard? I mean, there's just a lot of residents that are looking for some answers, and this thing's underwhelming, guys. Thanks.
Woodrow Hay, 427 Northwest 5th Avenue, Boynton Beach. I was hesitant to come up here as I was standing behind Harry because he read my mind very well. It is a little convoluted and a little scary. But I guess the only thing I would add, other than what he just articulated on very well, is that we resolve this very quickly, because the last thing you want to do is start scaring the developers that we are not organized and together at the top level. There are a lot of good projects that are in the pipe. A lot more are coming to the city of Boynton Beach. And I will say it now, as I said it before, and it got me in trouble, that we have a fantastic staff, and they will keep you guys on track as much as possible if you listen to them, okay? It's not the staff, it's you guys now. The last time I say it was us, because I was sitting where you are now. But it's you guys who make that final decision. The buck stops with you. And so what I'm saying to you is, get this resolved, because this was some of the things that were brought up in discussion when we were talking about taking the two citizens off the board. If you cannot come up with something that's comfortable with you, my suggestion is to go back to a 7-member independent board. That needs to be one of the items on the table that you discuss, because we want to show continuity, we want to show strength, and we don't want to be confused ourselves, neither do we want our developers and our citizens to be confused, okay? There's nothing wrong with what you guys are doing, but there's so much. I've gotten a lot of questions about it myself, and I can't explain it, okay? So I'm saying, sit down to the table with the attorney, with the executive director, come up with a viable solution, not to exclude a 7-member independent board. Thank you.
Buck Buchanan, 807 Ocean Inlet Drive. I do have a solution. Let's go back to the way it used to be. It used to be the CRA board approved CRA projects, not the P&D board. When the independent board was abolished, the decision was made by the city commission at that time to shift that responsibility to the P&D board. P&D board looks at things differently from the way the CRA board did, as far as including everything from design guidelines to everything else. So in order to get significant input from the CRA into the CRA projects, simply turn change, and the city commission can do this. You guys can't because you're the CRA board, but the city commission can do this. Just return the responsibility of CRA projects to the CRA board and CRA staff. It's that simple. Thank you.
Are there any additional comments? Joe, if you want to continue, that would be the time. Okay.
I have a comment.
Absolutely.
Thank you. First of all, you know, I understand that when individuals are giving comments, and sometimes we get sidetracked, but I'm just saying there's a way, you know, to let individuals know that we need to be moving on. But as far as that seven-member advisory board, I was there when it was a seven-member advisory board. I was here when it was a five-member advisory board. And whether we go back and forth right now, the dust has not settled with the CRA board that we have already established. I think we need to kind of like go to the table and work and find out what we need to do to find out where we all can come to a dialogue and make this work. I'm just saying, you know, because right now it seems like we don't know what we're doing, and I know what I'm doing. And I'm just saying we need to let things die down and have a meeting, you know, with the chair here, with our Mrs. Brooks, and then all of us.
The question is that could we ask the CRA advisory board what they would like to do for the CRA? Is that a yes or a no?
Well, what we are going to do is start bringing the agenda, this board's agenda, to the advisory board, and then we'll be putting a line item on each agenda item what the advisory board, if they voted up or down. But from a legal perspective, some things, because P&D hears these development projects and the CRA board doesn't, that is why your legal staff does not recommend adding that additional layer. If you in fact did hear the projects instead of P&D, which the reason they took that away is because the CRA board became the commission and it was going to the commission. So it would have been P&D, commission, commission, commission. So it wouldn't have made any sense if you're hearing what I'm saying. So, right. So there was some, when they did do away with the independent board, it made sense for it not to come to the CRA for review on one level. But if you are going to, when we had an independent board, and I've been here through every iteration that you can have of a CRA board under the state statute, we had architects, we had attorneys, real estate people. We actually had you had to meet certain qualifications because we did review plans. We did. So there was a certain rationale to it. So it's just food for thought. I'm just giving a little history. So
no, it's so I even forgot my question. So,
I know there's so much going on.
I think the question was is that we asked what the CRA wants to advise us on.
Tell them that yes, they can advise us on this, or no, they can't. So can we give them the free rein to say this is what we'd like to advise you on? And giving us, because I saw that there were 67 questions that they gave the CRA. I haven't had a chance to review all of them.
They are not going to be able, if they want something on the agenda, we are going to produce the agenda. If they want somebody on the agenda, just like you do, the same process you follow, they're going to ask, and you're going to say yes, you can have it on the agenda. It's following the same process. So they're basically, we are liaison to them, just like any other advisory board in the city. They have no more power or any less power. So they're no different than any other advisory board. Are you talking about this board?
Yes. Can they only
no,
sorry. Can they only advise this?
I don't
this?
Know. That's a legal question, probably to Jim, because that's a city commission
decision.
That's a city commission decision, not this board's decision.
Okay, and so can the city commission put stuff on the CRA advisory board's agenda?
I don't know. I guess so. I don't see why not. I know, it's a little confusing, isn't it, when you wear the same hat?
Yeah, because we can't do it here, but next week we could put something on the CRA.
You'd have to take that up with Jim.
Okay.
And ask him that question.
Wonderful.
Ms. Burke, I'm very disappointed. As we were forming, this is information that just came out here tonight, the pros and cons of advisory board, and we were developing this advisory board. I would have liked to have some legal direction and some more information like you're telling us here tonight. So I'm very disappointed in how this was presented to this board here. You're making us look pretty foolish in front of this crowd here, which didn't have to happen. And I put that on your shoulders. Thank you.
I'm not a lawyer, Chair. I'm not a lawyer. This came up because there was discussion at the last advisory board, which was last Thursday, about having a developer come in and all of that. And that's why it came up. The scope of this advisory board is not set by staff. It is set by the city commission. It is not set by staff. Let me be very clear.
Thank you very much for that. Okay, moving forward. Old business. Vivian?
An update on a project the CRA has been working on for quite some time. Actually, we were working on this when the eminent domain, the right to do eminent domain for development, economic development was struck down by a prior governor. This is an assembly on Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard, east of Seacrest, that we have been assembling piece by piece by piece. However, we do not own a total swath of land. There are pieces within our site that we do not own, but we worked with a developer called Housing Trust Group, and they came in and proposed that they would go and get what's called low-income housing tax credits, which pay for all of the development of a project except for the land, and then they would option the remaining three properties by the other ones. It actually worked out really well. They were going to pay us $2 million for our property, which was a great deal. This is actually adjacent, just east of the New Family Dollar. So they applied. The housing tax credits are administered by Florida Housing Finance Corporation. They are competitive. You have to meet a minimum score to apply. Then you get a lottery ball number. Literally, it's a lottery ball number. And if your lottery number is high, you are not going to get funded. Only one or two deals get funded in Palm Beach County a year. And you have anywhere from 15 to 30 applications in Palm Beach County. There's not that many sites anymore. So we didn't get it this year. Many sites go three, four, five times to try to get funded. So that's where we're at. This site did include the store on Martin Luther King Junior Boulevard that's near the Family Dollar. It also included some vacant, small vacant lots and a duplex. So they may be coming back to us soon for another try at the apple, another bite at the apple. There's no risk on our part. It's literally no risk. We simply signed a purchase and development agreement that lays out our responsibility, their timelines, development timelines, and all that. There's no risk to the CRA at all.
Okay.
So I just want to give you an update on that, of how we're trying to get these things developed and what it takes sometimes.
So looking on at the bottom, it says the CRA board can opt to take the following actions: hold on to its land and attempt to acquire the adjacent parcels for eventual future development, issue a request for qualifications and proposals in June 2016 in preparation for the next round of tax credit applications.
Yes. I recommend that we do that, that we go ahead and issue an RFP, RFQ in June to make another run at it.
So is this opening up to new developers?
Yes, it would.
And does the current developer have relationships with the property owners that said?
He does. Well, he did. I'm sure those contracts are out, you know, they're okay. out now. But I'm sure he would make another run at it. It's not easy, the prices they want, but I'm sure he'd be happy to. So.
Okay. Yes.
Vivian, I thought this last time here, this 9%, procedure wasn't going to be a lottery system. It was going to be based on merit versus
yes.
the lottery. Now you're saying it was a lottery system again?
The first one was. The second one was scoring.
Right.
And they did not score high enough. Neither one of our second applications on the revitalization, which is this one, they didn't score high enough. There's only one that selected an entire state in that round, because both these projects applied for another round of 9%, which was not lottery ball, but it was scoring totally more based on if it was in a CRA and that kind of thing. Neither one scored high enough. In this case, you had to have a high score. They didn't score high enough. It was a project in Orlando that got funded. So
Housing Trust has had a couple of bites at the apple already on this property, right?
Yes, they have.
The second time or third time they failed?
Second time.
Thank you.
Question is, does it have to be low-income housing in that area?
If you look at the demographics, there's... But
we don't have to have low-income housing there.
You'd either have to put a lot of subsidy into it, like probably we'd have to throw our land in and then put cash, a lot of millions of cash into it, and then it would probably sit vacant.
But if, let's say, we want to put, you know, MLK into a higher-end kind of place, we don't have to do low-income housing tax credits. We could say, you know what, we have faith that it's going to do better than it's actually showing.
Well, you'd probably, at that point, you'd have to decide to hold the land and wait for the rest of the area to come around. As we're investing in Model Block and Ocean Breeze East and other projects, and hope that area...
You're saying that it's not a good idea to put this as the nice area and hopefully the area around it builds around?
This is not, our property is not that big of an area. It's not big enough to make a huge change on MLK.
Okay.
It's just not that big.
Okay.
It's small. It's only like our land is probably 1.8 acres total. That's it. So it's pretty small.
So do we...
My hand is up.
Oops, thank you.
Thank you. First of all, I'm glad to see that it's going out to be rebidded and everything. And I'm just saying, my whole take is that, you know, since this group has already had two tries, my take is that hopefully somebody else will come in, you know, with some better material and things that we could kind of like jump on board with them and say, you know, let's give, you know, your group a shot. Now, I'm just saying they already failed twice. And I'm just saying perhaps the next person that come in will come in with a better plan and a better idea.
And the RFP doesn't say it has to be tax credits.
Right.
It will not say that. We're asking, what is your plan to make this happen?
We're not asking for the low-income housing tax credit.
No, that's,
so we can get any sort of developer who
yes,
wants it.
Yes, absolutely.
Wonderful. All right. Do we have a motion for what we can do?
Yeah, you can direct staff to bring back in June the RFQ, RFP.
Can I hear a motion on the...
Motion to have staff bring back RFPs in June.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. Moving along. Item B.
Thank you. I'm sorry if I'm breaking up. I lost my red nose thing. Same update, except on the Ocean Breeze site. Again, this is the developer we've worked with. It's called Related Urban. And they are an arm of Related, the very big development group that built Marina Village and took over the old promenade, which is now Costa Costa. They do have an affordable housing arm, and we entered into a purchase and development agreement with them in October for our site, which is Northeast 6th and 7th. It's a 4.5-acre site. They again were going to pay us $2 million for that property. The appraised value is 1.53 at the time. And they applied initially for the 9% competitive tax credits. They did not score, they did not get a good lottery number. They also applied for the 9% revitalization tax credits. And again, they did not score high enough. So they may want to talk to you. I believe they want to talk to you about coming back for 4% with some other different forms of finance. However, the gap is about $2.5 million, which would mean our property would be thrown in for free. I don't recommend that. I think the property, because it's one of the last whole pieces in this area, I think we can issue an RFP, RFQ this summer and find somebody who, you know, can hopefully do a good job at scoring. You can't control the lottery ball, but you know, maybe these guys are, they're both good. Actually, they're both very good at what they do. It's, you just can't control that lottery machine. So I just want to keep you up to date on it. But I do think we should not stop trying, but I don't think we should give away our property for free in this case, particularly Ocean Breeze East. On MLK, we may have to, but Ocean Breeze East, no.
Thank you. I'm not in favor of giving our property away, but I am in favor of sending it back out for RFPs and RFQs to come back in during the summer. Maybe somebody has to come to the table that will have a better idea, better plans that we could utilize and we can move this project forward.
Yes.
I mean, this is the second time they've had the bite at the apple mm-hmm. also. Mm-hmm. Has any other companies come forward other than these two companies for these parcels?
I had another person contact me, and I said, you know, they're going to be out of contract the end of May, so, you know, but I prefer to do an RFP, RFQ, and put that out on LoopNet and like we did before.
We've done that twice now, and these are the two companies that keep coming back on our, you
know. No, we had quite a few. Yeah. That as a result of the LoopNet, we had more than these two. We just selected these two. So
now is let's say if the related urban wanted to have them extend the contract, are we able to accept some consideration from them?
They have a deposit with us now.
Okay.
And like I said, the contract is in effect till the end of May, so you can. If they come forward, however, and you want to extend the contract, that's totally your option to allow them to go forward and try to do the next round of tax credits. You can do that.
Well, what happens to their deposit?
We would keep it.
So because they didn't win the lottery, they lost their deposit? Is that what you're saying?
No. The deposit's totally... it doesn't go hard until they actually get awarded the tax credits. That's how the agreement's written. So it's a deposit until they actually win the tax credits. So
you're saying that if they were going, so we're still holding their deposit. If
yes.
We ask for RFPs, RFQs, are we giving that deposit back?
Yes. Once the contract is over, we give that deposit back because we don't have a deal. We don't have any.
So it's a refundable deposit?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
It's not like a standard, you know, FAR bar agreement. So
arm's length transaction,
right?
I got you.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Microphone, they're saying you got to talk in the mic, please.
Ask that again?
No, well, I heard it, but I don't know if the clerk heard it.
I asked her and Vivian in terms of, we've chosen these companies twice now. What gave them the qualification that we've chosen them a second time around, and what will make them not or so get chosen?
We didn't choose them
a
second time. What happened was they have a purchase and development agreement that had a period of time, and that period of time happened to extend to allow them to apply for another round of funding, which was this revitalization tax credit. So they did that. They did both. They did the competitive and revitalization funding round. So it wasn't that we selected them twice. We didn't. It was just the purchase and development agreement had that timeline to allow them to have enough time to try to do potential other funding sources. So the other group, Housing Trust, they already canceled, they already said, you know, we're out of the contract, give us our deposit back. We already did that. So the whole thing that triggers whether the deal goes hard or not, in other words, whether it is a firm contract that's going to have to happen and close, is whether they got the tax credit allocation from the state of Florida. And neither one of them have gotten that. So they can, either one of us can get out of this now if we want to. Now, if Related comes to you, and they may, they spoke to me and said they may want to talk to you, each of you, about this, about either getting a new contract or amending this one to allow them to continue to make those attempts to get this funding. So that's totally up to you. I think we should go out again because it is, these are, you know, I just think it's fair to give other people a chance. They may be the ones that you select because they have competency in this area, but, you know, with these type of demographics, but, you know, you may select somebody else. Somebody else may say, hey, I got a line on this great project, and let me bring it in. So it just opens up the door again to other people.
Director, do you have any other recommendations as far as, you know, our two options, as you've kind of outlined, for these types of properties seem to be to roll the dice with the lottery or to give away the properties? Is there any middle ground or any ideas that you've seen work before where we could come out better than rolling the dice or giving everything away?
Oh, I don't believe in giving these properties away. I think if you look at Delray Beach, and I hate to compare it to Delray, but it's so close and it's in the paper a lot, but they have land banked. And in areas, that's for 30 years. I'm not recommending that.
Well, no, that's I'm not either. I wouldn't want to give any of the land away. But if those seem to be the only two outlined options that would get these projects moving, is there a way for us to come up with other options that don't involve giving everything away or banking on a very low probability lottery system?
We marketed this property very heavily on LoopNet. I don't know if you're familiar with that. It's, you may be, but it's a commercial real estate. It's where everybody looks for commercial property. And we got a lot of calls. We got a lot of response to it. It really was when they got to where it is and the demographics and what could the rent be. The cost to build is the cost to build. It doesn't matter where you're building. The concrete is the concrete, the glass is the glass, the steel is the steel. It's when you get to the rent, there's a gap in the project. There's a development gap, and then there's an operational gap. So either we fill it with our property, or they find a way to fill it with some government program. And that's the fact. Every house in Model Block is getting gap financing from the city through the form of the property. Is free and clear to the builders. So until we get enough synergy going where that doesn't have to happen, where we don't have to be the thing that makes the wheel move, it's going to be that way. So, however, Ocean Breeze East is so close to downtown that I don't think we need to give that property away. My gut says hang in. We will receive a good value for that property. We'll get a great project there. It may not, and when you say low-income housing tax credits, it's a misnomer because Palm Beach County has, they go by Palm Beach County demographics, not the city's demographics. They go by the median household income for Palm Beach County. So Palm Beach County's median household income is pretty high. So when you take that and you use that, it's 50% of that, and then they do 30% of the units higher than that. So it's not what you think it is. People have a very bad idea of it. There's a lot of these around, and you wouldn't know that that's what they are. So you would not know. So they're beautiful. They have granite counters. They have this Energy Star appliances, tile floors, wood cabinets. They're just like any other apartment. There's no difference. They have to build to a certain standard under IRS rules. So there's a lot to this, and I don't want to give you a big lesson tonight, but it really is not what people think it is. So it's just not. So
the last question is, what is the deposit?
$25,000.
Okay. And so we collected interest on that at least?
We got our .01 interest.
Okay. All right.
Bernie Madoff wasn't available.
No. Can we get a motion?
Can we get, before we get the motion, I'd just like to ask Mrs. Brooks a question. What's the certainty? You've said, hello?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Thank you. You said during the summer, the last one we went for, you want this one to go for the same time, like around May or June?
June. I'm going to bring both it to you in June if that's the desire of the board.
Okay, I'd like to offer a motion that we send staff out to get an RFPQ and have it timeline for June.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Passes unanimously. Okay. Next is item C.
Board Chair, board members, welcome. Mike Simon, Assistant Director with the CRA. The item before you is just a simple project update. We have a large final phase of the marina master redevelopment plan that's going to be taking place in the area of July this summer. The information I provided you was a kind of a brief timeline of from acquisition until where we are today. I'm happy to go through that with you if you would like. But the backup documentation provided shows you the redevelopment plan itself. We have completed the slip reconstruction project, the tower entry feature project, the harbor master building project, and the final phase of this overall project is the waterfront open space project, which is at the corner of Casa Loma and 6th Avenue, 6th Street. Which again is in plan approval, and all we have left to do is select a contractor and bring that to you hopefully in June.
Question regarding the CRA boats, the marina boat slips, is that owned by the CRA or is that?
It is owned by the CRA.
Okay.
And now, there are many slips that are in the marina overall. If you look at the first image on the attachment, one is the an aerial of the marina, and I've tried to label other than the sea mist, which are the two boats in the bottom left corner. You can see where the CRA owns their slips. To the east of us is the two Georgia slips, and then on the north inlet basin is the privately owned marina, Village Marina slips. So we own the 19 slips that are on the south side of that, of the drive aisle and the median there.
West of Two Georges.
On the way to Two Georges.
Okay. And now, are those slips open for bidding or?
They are currently leased through a dockage agreement and at a rate that's set by the CRA board. Okay. They're on an annual renewal. They are designed to be commercially rented. That was the decision of the board to gradually eliminate the few private vessels in 2006 that were there and replace them with active commercial businesses. And I think that was a good decision. I think it's been successful as far as generating more marine-oriented businesses in the marina that's owned by the CRA. That was really the intent of the acquisition, was to try to preserve the marine businesses that were there from being bought by a commercial or private developer that might turning into, you know, just a regular dock, which would just have private vessels and not much activity. That'll be coming to you this summer, the new agreements, the new slip rates. But yes, at this point, they're all on an annual renewal.
Okay, wonderful.
And it is full. The marina is full.
Vice Chair.
Thank you. Mike, before, that was a problem with the road over there. Did we ever get that fixed?
In the description on the agenda cover and in the plans for the marina open space project, the road maintenance will be handled at the same time that the open space project is done. The roadways overlap to a degree where you want to continue that road improvement. We had several geotechnical tests done this, let's say, several months ago to further evaluate the reason for the subsidence. There isn't a breach in the seawall, so that was good news. We're not going to have to redesign and rebuild the exfiltration trench, which is even better news. So the project essentially is a maintenance design project and not a complete rebuild of that road. So it will be handled in kind of, you have the open space project that is currently designed and you see, and then you have a road maintenance project that will attach to that, same contractor hopefully.
All right. I just want to get it for the record because I know when the project came before us, this was a problem. And I'm glad you don't hear that, you know, for the new individuals that's up here, that it has been worked out.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
There are images in your backup, too, of I believe I can try to include some of those subsidence pictures. We're happy to send those to you, obviously, at any time.
I'm good.
I just one other comment. The Marina Village owns the public parking and is charging a fee to use the marina. Is that something that we can do something about to not have a fee to park there?
The Marina Village Master Association owns the envelope in which the parking spaces, both residential and commercial, are housed. The individual resident and the condominium unit owner, and in our case, the CRA, which we obtained commercial spaces for the Harbor Master area, which was originally a commercial site, not a public site. All those are property contained within the Master Association area. So we own the spaces, but the maintenance and the management of that garage, gates, both on the residential side and on the non-residential side, are managed by the marina. If we wanted to subsidize the cost to manage our public spaces or commercial spaces rather than charge the public, which was a consideration for the brought before the board 18 months ago, that is an option if you want to revisit that. But at this time, the authority over the garage lies with the Master Association and their decision, short of getting offset costs from the CRA or other commercial owners, would be to charge the management fee. It's been a great success as far as operation of the garage. We have not lost, despite threats of leaving last year, we haven't lost a single tenant due to the charge. We haven't seen any decrease in business. Quite the contrary, business is better than it was the year before. But again, that's a decision that the public, that the CRA board can make on behalf of those businesses. The CRA-owned businesses don't contribute to, other than in marina operations, they're not directly offsetting any of their customers' costs by validating tickets for, let's say, for their guests or what have you. But currently, that's how it stands. Certainly, under your purview, to change that.
All right. And is that something we could put on a future agenda item?
Yes, sir. Right. Yeah, they'll stop the charge in July.
Okay.
We can put it into, I don't know that we have budget line item specifically for that this time, but it certainly could be part of the budget discussion for next year. It'll stop in July and it'll kick back in December. So there'll be a window where there won't be charges, and that'd be the time that you could make a decision if you so choose to offset that or address it in a different way.
Wonderful. Okay. Was there a recommendation? Okay. Is there any more discussion? Okay. Moving on to item D.
Chair, excuse me. Before we move on, what's wrong with the air conditioning tonight? Can somebody please tell me? Oh, okay. Thought the heater was on. Go ahead.
No. This is Florida. All right. Now we're on the status update on Cottage District redevelopment.
Okay, this is a project that we started assembling back probably in 2007. Yeah, 2007. This block, if you look at the aerial that I've included in the backup, if you look at the block, it's very large compared to the blocks to the north and south of it because it has a middle piece that is not accessible for development. It's just stuck there. We're not sure why. We're not sure what the rationale for that was back in the 20s or whatever when they platted this. So we started, one of the rationales for a CRA also is to correct these kind of platting issues when you read the state statute. So we started acquiring it. We've acquired 16 separate parcels. And one of our challenges in assembling property is these lots in these older neighborhoods, they're 50 to 60 feet wide by 100 deep. And you need a whole bunch of them to do anything. And they're all owned by different people. So you can imagine the challenge of actually trying to make a development parcel. But we persist. And so we've been doing this for a while. So we have the primary source of the money was from bond issuance, too. So we spent the money for that. We're trying to create a new neighborhood. And I included an example of what we're looking at. It's something totally different for Boynton, which will be a little bit higher income, home ownership. It's something that's done in the Northwest a lot. It's called a cottage district. The houses are sort of clumped together. They're smaller houses. Then there's green space. So there's a little more of a, it's a little different form than we have now. And I think in working with planning staff, we think we can do this. We may have to do a code amendment to make it happen. What we're doing right now is we're working on the clearing the title, making sure it's all clear, do a survey, get that ready so we can do a request for developer qualifications and proposals late summer. This is part of our strategic plan, and it's also part of the Heart of Boynton redevelopment plan update. This is all part of what the CRA board and the city commission have said are priorities for staff. So that's what we're working on, and we budgeted $100,000 in this year's budget to do the survey, soil, you know, prepare everything for developers to come in and give us their best ideas of how to make this happen.
So if we need to, so if this cottage district needs to be replatted, is that something that the developer would go to the city commission for the replatting?
They could replat it themselves. We can do it on their behalf. We may work with them on that. We replatted ourselves at Ocean Breeze West. We found it made it a lot easier. But I really am looking for some creativity from the development community of how they think it would work best, because the layout of what we own on that block is a little funky if you look at it. So I'm looking at somebody to come in and say, what's the best way it's going to work?
What is this currently zoned?
It's single family.
So there is no chance for a duplex or?
We can change it to IPUD, but right now IPUD only goes to 5 acres. But we think we're going to change the code to say IPUD can go up to so many acres in the CRA. So to accommodate making this happen, because we want to allow the IPUD infill plan unit development allows flexibility in your design, which you see a lot of these townhome projects on East, North and South Federal are IPUD projects. So
maybe because I don't understand, what does IPUD stand for?
Infill planned unit development.
Okay.
I know, it's, I didn't make it up.
All right. And then there's no require for motion that.
I'm going to bring this back to you in the form of a, in a form of a
RFP
proposal.
Or RFP a RFP. Land banking.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Late summer.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. I have a comment. Ms. Brooks, you said that you don't know why this got like this. Well, I'm going to give you some history right now. Well, this was when it wasn't feasible in Boynton that you had to have your lots platted, et cetera. And then it was like Shotgun's home was in there, and people who had money, if they could fork out a little piece of property and put a home there, that's what happened. So that's why we got in the predicament we're in. But when we started platting the property here in Boynton, then this is that little section that remained there, but everything has started falling in place. I can only say because I've been here 64 years. Okay.
Okay. Any additional comments? All right, moving forward. Item E, status update on the model block project.
Again, this is a project that is on the strategic plan, your strategic plan that is your guiding document really for the CRA and the city, how to move forward and actually get results and, you know, show accountability for what we do. Funding and staff. This is a project that the CRA and city started working on probably a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. On it's Northwest 11th and Northwest 10th, west of Seacrest, just south of Point Santa Elementary, building single-family for-sale homes, high quality. They're appraising at about $180,000, which is a good step for that neighborhood. And we're buying land. The city already had some lots. We're doing streetscapes. Utilities is doing a utility improvement project on 11th, and they're going to take the road through to the cross street to alleviate traffic for the school. So a lot of good things are going to come out of this project. Stabilization of that block, stabilization of the neighborhood with home ownership, beautification. So we just bought a property, or we're closing on it tomorrow, I think, that has been historically a problem in the community with illicit activities. So that's a big movement. It's been a problem. I think I see Brian Fitzpatrick. He's going to be happy when I tell him which one it is. He knows exactly. So these are things that, while they seem small in the big, you know, 50-gallon barrel of what we have to do, there are the steps you have to take to get to fill that barrel of all the good things. And it doesn't happen overnight. There's not enough resources. But we have made so much progress in that community. And the people who live there tell us all the time. We see the change. You know, my mother went by there with her friends and says, wow, I can't believe the change. So if my mother can see it, then I know the residents can see it. So I'm happy to be part of it. I love it.
Ahmed. Thank you. Since I represent that district, that property that you just spoke of that we'll be closing on tomorrow, we was going out to have to take that property by eminent domain, but since the seller came as a willing seller, that's how we acquired that property. And I just want to say to you all, you know, job well done. Thank you.
Comments? All right. So we're up to F, consideration of approval of major site plan modification 480 East Ocean Avenue.
Mr. Jim, this is a project that the CRA, we wanted to do a public parking lot right near City Hall to accommodate the growth in on Ocean Avenue, because you don't want to put your parking lot on your main street. So we built a beautiful public parking, not garage, yeah, just surface parking. But it's pretty darn nice, I have to say, with two EV charging stations for everyone who has an electric car. But as part of that, buying that property, there was a little house there that looked like nothing until we went into it. And it was a really old house that had been there a really long time. And Mike and I went in there, and it was original. Nothing had been changed, and it was solid. And we said, we got to save this house. What could we do with this house? What possibly could we do with it? And we just started looking, and we said, let's move it to this corner that the city owned and make it into a restaurant. And we did. So our first tenant didn't quite have it together. But we actually hired a restaurant broker, Tom Prakas. He's been around a long time. He knows everyone in the business. He got us Mr. Richard Lucibella, who's buying this, and he's going to lease it to Lisa Mercado, who has the living room on Congress Avenue. And they're going to enclose the porch and make it a permanent enclosure, air-conditioned space, more seating. Very wise move. They're going to put a hood in. The prior tenant did not want a hood, which means you can't really cook on site, which wasn't, I don't think, the wisest decision. But so this is before you, because in our purchase and development agreement, the board reserves the right to look at the site plan and make comments to it. Because it's our property, or was our property. We did close on it. We got the money. And it sold at appraised value. We sold it at appraised value. We did not give it away.
Is that the $249,000?
Oh, no. That's, no. The purchase price was $335,000. The city gave us the land. Do we have to split the money with you? Should have negotiated that before, Lori. So I'm going to have Jim Williams, who's the architect, kind of give you a little overview of what's involved. Put it on the big screen. I don't know how clear that's going to be for you, but go ahead. Okay.
Jim Williams, Acevedo Williams Architects, 7700 Congress Avenue, Boca Raton. We're also very happy to be part of this project. It's reestablishing some of the fabric of the neighborhood. And I think when we get all of these new residents online, this will be a great little neighborhood place, as it started to be previously. The problem was there was never enough seating to make a go of it, and the restaurant being serviced from afar with no hood was also an issue. So when Rich and his partner hired us and said they wanted to make this a beautiful place again and something that would be great for the neighborhood, they brought in the operator of the living room, and we sat down and looked at what she could do. She'll be doing some remote cooking as well at the living room. But we did manage to get a small hood in, a small cook line, rearrange the bar slightly, enclose the porch with a moving glass wall so that in good weather it can open up. Not detracting from the cottage itself, everything out there is glass, and we're using a translucent roof panel, so it'll be a very light structure, almost doubling the seating capacity. We're going for 47 seats inside and 24 outside. She can make a go of it financially with that, and we think it's going to be a great putback for Boynton Beach. Let's see if we can open up one of these other. We get in here. Okay. So on this view, you see the cottage, which has the tin roof, and it's intact, pretty much as you see it today. It's got a green awning out front for the front porch. The intent is to open the fireplace both sides, so you'll get it in both rooms, and then the glass walls that you see coming to the left there and straight on in the lower view, that's the new addition. That's basically it. It is a little space. The addition is 525 square feet, but it'll make all the difference for the project. Any questions?
I have one, Jim. Jim, I see the sidewalk seating. Is that sidewalk wide enough to handle?
Yes, there was seating there before, and they will have to come through for their permitting for this application, but it is wide enough, and it meets all the criteria for sidewalk seating clearances.
Are they still looking for, I think I recall them mentioning they wanted to put, like Hurricane Alley has the like the barriers, kind of like the little fence enclosure on the edge of the sidewalk. Are they still looking for that?
I don't know that level of detail. We haven't discussed it with them, but we have discussed with the planning department the need for a separate permit for the sidewalk dining, and the space is there to meet the criteria for the clearance on the sidewalk.
My question is that, thank you. My question is that the addition, is that going to be hurricane resistant?
Yes, it will definitely meet the Florida building code.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Do we know what type of food that they plan on serving and the hours?
That I don't know. I'm sure it will be great. The living room got some great reviews recently in the Palm Beach Post, and she'll be doing similar food to what she does there. I think small plates and emphasizing the local brew pub idea as well. The bar is set up with, you know, maybe 20 taps.
Oh,
so
wow.
That's definitely going to be something for them.
And we do have breweries here in Boynton, so right. That sounds great. All right. Are there any other comments? And are we, do I hear a motion to approve?
Moved.
Second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Passes unanimously.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, item G, consideration approval of major site plan modification 211 East Ocean Avenue.
Thank you. This is another project that's owned, a building that's owned by the CRA that we purchased. It's, to my knowledge, I think it's the oldest building in the city, built by Oscar Magnuson. And it's all wood, so, but it's in very good shape considering its age. We entered into a purchase and a development agreement with local development company, and they have submitted on time, according to our agreement, the major site plan modification to the city, March 4th. And it's a, they're keeping the historic structure intact. They're not really changing the outside. They are adding to the back, restrooms, public restrooms, and a cooking area. And then they're adding a porch on the side. Very cool concept, very exciting. I think between 480 and this, you're going to see, and 500 Ocean, this is, these are the game changers of Boynton Beach. I think you're seeing some real, real improvements here. And I don't know.
Yes, again, Jim Williams, Acevedo Williams Architects. Again, we were honored and pleased to be part of this. Tom Prakas called us the end of last year and asked if we could help him illustrate his idea for this. And when we heard his ideas, it was very exciting. Everybody in my office wants to be there for the opening and hang out. He's talking about a bocce court, which you see in the rear, which isn't something foreign to Boynton Beach. You've got some great courts along Federal Highway. A beer garden to the front. It's the trellised area you see to the lower right. The existing building exterior intact. We're restoring the front porch that we saw in some of the old photographs. And then adding, the existing building is about 1,500 square feet on two floors. We're adding about another 2,000 square feet of kitchen, full kitchen, hood, coolers, exterior cooler, an indoor-outdoor bar that you see in the middle there that's kind of that O shape. So it's half inside and half on a covered porch. The bocce court in the rear. Fire pits in the back and in the front. Again, just a cool place to gather and be there. And again, the idea with the local breweries will be high here. That's, you know, wine and beer kind of a place. His idea here, and again, it's evolving, but small plates and definitely a place to get a meal. It's not just a bar and a hangout place, but the idea is make it a comfortable neighborhood environment. Yeah. Let's go to the other views, maybe.
Tim, what part are you taking down?
Okay, here are the elevations.
Okay.
We're not taking anything down of the historic structure, and we have talked with the city, the planning department, the historical reviewer. His only comment when he saw the plan was make sure when we restore the windows, we use historical profiles and keep it looking like it does. So the addition, the view in the lower left corner is the front view, and you can see the new porch added there. They'll be dining on the porch. They'll be dining right inside that room. So there's some dining inside, some outside. And then to the rear, that low metal roof that you see is behind. It's behind and extending out to the east. They're just going to have administrative offices on the upper floor. So you see that stair coming up on the lower right-hand side there. And again, that shows you the addition to the back with the kitchen. So most of the additional space is going to the rear and the rear east. The landscape plans, which are going to be very exciting, he asked us to go take a look at, in Jupiter, the Guanabana. Yeah. And he said he wants that kind of a jungle feel on the east side and around the bocce court. So the landscape architect's having a good time with that. And that's the concept.
You know, as we know, it gets hot in Florida summer. Are there any sort of plans for fans or any sort of cooling devices?
Yes. Fans for sure. The misting cooling devices don't really work well in Florida. They just make you wet. and kind of clammy. They work in Nevada where it's really dry and that evaporation cools you down. But a lot of fans, and the indoor dining area will be air conditioned, so you'll have a choice of in or out.
And you're saying that the landscaping will provide shade?
Yes, there'll be a lot of landscaping enhancing. Some of what's there will stay. Most of it will stay, but there'll be a lot more enhancement to it.
And that there is, you're aware that there's a vacant lot next to it, though? Is it?
To the west.
Correct.
Yes, and our driveway comes through and connects to the alley on that west side. There's separation there, and there's a landscape buffer along that driveway.
Okay, and then is there a pathway? And I see that.
Yeah, there's already a public connection on the east going back to the parking areas.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We created a public pathway late at night to the public parking lot. Yeah, have you seen that? Anyone?
Yeah.
No? Okay.
And you're saying that they're going to use the easement for towards the back of?
Well, no, the alley will remain. Again, it gives more separation. There's a residential use across to the back there. The alley will remain, separating both, and there'll be a heavy landscaping barrier back there.
Okay. Question? All right. Can I hear a motion?
Okay. Thank you.
Approve the major site plan modification.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Passes unanimously.
Excuse me, Board Chair, yes. Mike Simon again, Assistant Director. I just wanted to take the opportunity to use these two properties as an example of why this is coming before you, since there was some discussion earlier. It's before you as a site plan review, not as an official body of a site plan review, as you would sit or as the others would sit outside the CRA. It is part of your contract being an owner of the property. So when the CRA has a vested interest in the property, it generally comes to you for a more detailed discussion than it would normally, a project that's outside your purview. So I just wanted to, in case there was any part of you that might be wondering what just happened, just thought I would take that opportunity.
So you're clarifying that because the city owns the CRA owns the property and has it written in contract to approve it is the only reason why the CRA board approves the site plan?
Correct. In this case, yes.
Okay. Thank you. All right. We're finished old business. On to new business. Update on Riverwalk Project 1543 South Federal Highway.
Sounds like you guys already have gotten all the scoop by meeting with everyone, so I guess I don't really need to. I don't know, unless you want me to. There's really nothing new under the sun, except their comments have gone back to the developer from staff after the DART meeting. They'll have another DART meeting. I'm not sure when they'll get the comments back to set the date for that. I don't know if they have a date set for that because they have to submit their comments back to city staff. So that's where that's at.
And if can we open the floor to public comments?
Yeah.
All right. Is there any public comments regarding the update on the Riverwalk project?
Harry Woodworth, 685 Northeast 15th Place. Again, speaking for INCA. Thank you very much for the opportunity. The only comments we have on this right now, this thing is scary. I mean, first off, there's no public input. The developer didn't provide any facts to the public. There's this going on about who came to who. The developer says the cities, this is all the city's idea. The people I've talked to in the city said, oh, we didn't think of this. So we're not quite sure how this thing grew from the five or six stories he originally showed everybody around town about a year ago to the 10 stories it currently is. Would invite everybody to sit at the corner of Seacrest, look at the water tower to the right. Imagine that thing 500 feet square sitting on the left. And the problem we're having with it right now is the process. It's being rushed along. The 524 is the next date that they're planning to take it to the P&D board, although that's not being discussed. That's what's being put out there. We're a little concerned about that because we're going to do a rezoning simultaneous because the building's illegal as it's currently proposed. So the solution to that is we'll simply rezone all the MU3s, and then we'll put the building in, it'll perfectly comply. I think the normal process would be you'd separate the zoning. If you're going to do zoning in a city, do the zoning, have your normal public reviews and all the stuff that zoning's about. get the zoning done, and then come in with your project and say, okay, now let's talk about the project. So there's a lot of concern about this thing just going like a freight train with every avenue for public input shut down. Big problem.
As for your comment about the zoning, if I'm not mistaken, you have to have the site plan with the zoning at the same time.
Well, normally you would have your zoning in place. In this process, you can't really do the site plan review until the zoning's done. So I make sure a public meeting sitting up here where you're going to do them both simultaneously. One will be item B, one will be item C, which totally excludes the public from the opportunity to have any kind of review on the zoning.
And that would be at the planning and development because...
Well, now the planning and development is just going to review the project. They're like the other committees. They'll just throw it over here. But the commission, I believe, makes the decision on zoning.
But the planning and development, it would be the right time to make the public comments.
Well, I would hope so, but you gave the opportunity, so I want to come up.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, just quick, I assure you this is not going to be fast-tracked. It's going to be really vetted out. And
we certainly hope so.
I can promise you that.
I've been here 30 years, and I've never seen 30 years, I've never seen so many citizens so upset.
I was there. I understand.
Okay. Yes.
Good evening. Brian Fitzpatrick, 409 Northeast 1st Street, perhaps. Property owner, Boynton Beach. I just want to throw in an additional or a opposing point of view. I mean, I'm pretty excited about Riverwalk. I mean, for years I've thought having that Winn-Dixie, it's been one failed grocery store after another, a loading ramp backing up to the Intercoastal. I thought it was a colossal waste of waterfront property. I would just caution you to be just... with a grain of salt, some of the comments that you're receiving from some alleged groups that throw these numbers of at you 500 or 5,000 members, when it appears that a lot of the individuals behind these groups are not even Boynton Beach residents and or property owners, perhaps, you know, maybe they're from across the Intercoastal and it's not in my backyard kind of development that they're trying to influence here. Anyhow, that's all I have to say about that. Thank you very much for your consideration.
Thank you. All right. Got update. Is there any more discussion from the board? All right. We're moving on to B, update on the Ocean One project, 114 North Federal Highway.
I just want to update you on this. This project is not actually moving through the development process, and the other one is not moving quickly through it either. Just so you know, there is no fast track. We don't have fast track. There's no such thing in our code. The code is the code, and it has a legal process that it follows. And just for the edification of the public, there is a due process that has to be afforded to somebody who submits a site plan. And a mixed-use project, in order to get the mixed-use zoning, you have to submit a site plan. That is in our code. So there's nothing that has been said that is really correct. So there has been so many meetings with that developer. There's been more meetings with that developer than I've seen in a long time. So because it is a complicated project. So there is no fast tracking going on at all. It's been very protracted and drawn out, quite frankly. Update on Ocean One Project. This is at the corner of Boynton Beach and Federal, the old Bank of America site, for anyone who remembers that one. Right now it's vacant. We own the corner piece right at Boynton and Federal. We purchased the old motel there to create the Boynton Beach Boulevard extension that allowed Marina Village to be developed and also create the walkway to the intercoastal area for the public. We retained that little corner piece. It's not very big. It's under quarter acre. It's appraised at around $450,000, $460,000, and really you can't build much on it because of the shape and the size. Mr. Camelier of Ocean One, who owns the adjacent property, has requested through a letter of intent the use of our property for $10 or the sale of it to him. The board approved that, and we're going through the statutory process of intent to dispose of the property so that he can develop a project on the corner of Boynton Beach and Federal, right across from Casa Costa. And that process is being followed. The 30 days is up. Now it has to go on the commission agenda. Again, state statute process. These are processes that we have to follow, and the city has to follow. So just understand that we're not making it up as we go. And then once the city approves that the CRA can dispose of it at below market value, then Mr. Camilleri can take his project through the development process, because we as an owner, our board cannot sign off as on the site plan application, because we have to get this development, this disposal process completed. So just so you understand, that's where it's at. The project is on proposed to be on 1.98 acres. They're proposing 230 units in an eight-story building with structured parking. They have a little bit of commercial, not much, 2,600 square feet. It's not very much. They're at 100 units to the acre. That they are underparked right now. That's a big problem. So we're going to see how they're going to solve that. So while we're waiting for all this statutory process to run out, we've been trying to work with them on the site plan, some of the issues that we have, because we will enter into an agreement with them for a number of things that we want, which is, you know, a good site plan, and the board may want some other things. I don't know what the desire of the board is out of this developer as well. So that will. And I guess I need to hear from you guys if there is anything that you want me to put in that agreement in addition to site plan approval. We generally put site plan approval in, and any time we have a financial relationship, we will put that in there. But if there's anything else that is desired by the board.
Well, you know, we have three new members on the board here, right. So what else could we ask for?
Oh, what else can you ask for?
Yes.
I don't know. What do you want to ask for?
for example, what is, you know, besides the site plan approval, what could we, you know, could we ask for green space? Could we ask for, you know, what?
We've asked for an additional public space because they didn't have much at all, like zero. We've addressed some of that stuff already with them because that's just, They really didn't have any space. We asked for a plaza, public plaza, at Boynton and Federal. We asked for more retail because we really think, even though the demand might not be there today, we believe in the future it will be. So there's things like that we asked for. I don't know what each of your, you know, vision is. So that's something I'm not, you know, you just got in Tuesday. So we haven't had enough interaction to know what each of your desires are for the downtown. So.
Discussion?
Not a discussion, but Vivian, for this project, parking is really going to be a problem. Am I correct in saying that?
Right now they're fairly short. I mean, they're okay. Pretty short. And parking's a huge problem there now. Marina Village, when they built Marina Village, the developer retained 80 parking spaces, did not turn them loose. They're still available on the roof, and they will not turn them loose. And I think Linda can back me up there. We've tried working with them, but with Related, and I don't know why they won't either sell them at a decent price or whatever. So they're short on parking, Marina Village, because of that. And so everybody parks on the Boynton Beach Boulevard extension already, which you're really not supposed to. And they're parking all over. So if this project's short, I don't know where they're going to park. I mean, they're going to be parking. I don't know. I don't know where they're going to park. Okay. They're going to park on the rest of the Bank America site probably in the interim. But when that gets redeveloped, I don't know where they're going to go.
I find it strange that Related, using your own words, hold us hostage for 80 parking spaces, but yet comes back to us asking us to extend the contract on another piece of parcel of land. I find that, you know, doesn't look like they're playing fair. Just a point of information. Thank you.
When Regulated Group did the garage, they really kind of...
Can you state your name?
Oh, I'm sorry. Linda Cross, 625 Casa Loma Boulevard, Unit 601, Boynton Beach. Yeah. I live in Marina Village. When the developer built the garage, the actual 80 spaces that the developer owns, it's 70-some, are on the roof. You can't get to the roof unless you go through the gate. Can't get through the gate unless you live in the buildings. So the problem is that rather than assign the parking spaces to the owners in the condos from the roof down, they assigned them from level two up. So those 80 spaces are virtually worthless to either the developer because nobody can come through the gates unless they're a resident or of either the condos or the marina or the townhouses. And so the problem is the spaces aren't really worth anything. Nobody can use them unless any condo owner buys them, but the assigned spaces have already been assigned. So in order to move everybody up, you'd have to take everyone's parking space, 349 units, everyone who have usually two parking spaces, everyone's parking space and move them all up in order to open up that parking deck. So the bottom line is it was done wrong from the very beginning, and there's not really a whole lot those 80 spaces are going to do. Right now the developer will sell them to residents because only residents can go up past the gate. But other than that, he's actually holding the Master Association hostage, not the CRA, because he's supposed to turn those spaces over to the Master Association upon the turnover of the building. But because he still owned property at Casa Costa, he didn't have to turn those spaces over. Because he still owns two marina slips, he doesn't have to turn those spaces over. So he's actually holding the Master Association at Marina Village hostage, not really the CRA, just so you know.
Thank you. Is there any additional public comments for Ocean One Project? Seeing none. Michael, do you have a comment?
No, I'm just waiting for the next item.
Oh, okay. Sorry. All right, let's move on.
Very excited.
Next item, consideration of interlocal agreement between the CRA and the City of Boynton Beach for the CRA District Clean Program. All right.
Board Chair, Board Members, Mike Simon, Assistant Director with the CRA. Mm-hmm. The item before you is the consideration of the interlocal agreement between the CRA and the City of Boynton Beach for the CRA District Clean Program. This was a program that was approved during... last year's formation of the budget as a project. It is taken some time to formulate exactly who and how these areas that were identified in the map attached to the item would be cleaned, how often. We had set aside funding, but the actual program itself had not been developed until just recently. So the reason, let me tell you, the program itself will be a cleaning of the mapped streets, which are NLA Boulevard, Northwest 10th Avenue, from Seacrest to Federal, East Boynton Beach Boulevard from 95, essentially to past right to the edge of the Marina Village, the promenade entrance, North and South Federal Highway from about 2nd Avenue north to the canal, C-16 Canal, and Ocean Avenue. The city is utilizing some of their vendors to address these areas 3 days a week, 7 hours a day. They've divided up the areas into 2 and 1 hour blocks so that each will be addressed, as I said, 3 days a week. We will be billed, that's about $800 a week, I'm sorry, for the cost of that. The CRA, by entering into the interlocal agreement, protects our agency's integrity with regard to state statute and funding of city-identified vendors and or projects. We want to make sure that that's nice and clear between the two agencies. Again, we have a budgeted $50,000 from this year's budget which will not be utilized, can at the budget time decide to be carried over into a program that would continue. The ILA provides a termination date for September 30th, 2016, but provides also that the agreement can be amended by both parties' approval. So if the program goes well for the next 4 or 5 months, and the, both agencies or certainly the CRA board wants to continue funding, then we can address the extension at that time.
Comments?
Yeah. First of all, Mike, I'd like to know why Barton Memorial Park was not included in this cleanup.
I can answer that. The city already cleans that.
They do?
Yeah, they're supposed to.
Oh, they do?
And very importantly, also, for state statute, this is services that are over and above the city's normal scheduled cleanup. Obviously, the CRA under statute can't fund existing maintenance schedules and or property. So this is an over and above and clearly a special project, the CRA District Clean Program.
Okay, bus runs. It's not really bus runs. It's really bus stops. It's where the shelters are, where they get on and off loading and unloading.
Yes, sir.
Yes, bus stops.
Okay, bus stops.
Yes, sir. Yeah, both
runs.
Sides of the street, okay. As you see on the map. That's the. It's basically an enhanced over and above. You know, if they're going there once a week or twice, this is kind of focused attention. It may prove to need more time. You know, we may find out over the course of the next couple of months that 7 hours. 3 days a week isn't enough. It needs to be a 5-day week, but I think it's a great step in the right direction to see if that will have an effect, address some of the concerns of the community.
Right, I have another question. Who cleans up that place up there where it says CVS? Who's responsible for that? That bus stop?
Oh, the bus stop? Oh.
Yeah.
To my knowledge, CVS is responsible for that.
They are?
Just like I believe so. All the landscaping and the right-of-way, unless they've turned the right-of-way over, but that would be an agreement with the City Planning and Development Department and not necessarily the CRA. But we can certainly find out and let you know.
Well, whoever the responsibility is, they need to check into it, because I'm just saying it's very derelict. Nobody's really cleaning that up. I'm sorry, you know.
Yes, sir. I'm sure it's a code enforcement item that has been some recent discussions with the city.
Okay. Yes.
Michael, this is a concern of the citizens, the trash and litter down there?
Yes.
I have a hard time. Well, the city has a trash program here, pick up, does a great job with it. Why are we spending $50,000 to pick up trash? I just see that we're enabling these people or that complain that we would encourage them they're going to get that Monday. They're going to get that Wednesday. They got a crew that comes in here and picks it up. Are we encouraging that type of thought process? That's what I'm concerned about. And why do we stop in this area? Why not go up off further down South Federal or up Boynton Beach Boulevard? Why are we going to stop doing this for all neighborhoods? CRA district.
That's
I understand
the purview
that.
Of the board. I mean, we're doing this based on direction from the board. So
okay. I think it's incumbent upon people to take care of their litter and trash. I've taken walks down Martin Luther Boulevard. We had the parade there, mm-hmm. And there's those trash receptacles right there. And right outside those trash receptacles are piles of trash. How do you encourage that? Maybe we should have more programs that. Or teaching programs to encourage this, and maybe we should get into the schools at an early age to these students, to the kids, and say, look, you drop it, you pick it up, you put it in a container. I don't see this helping the situation other than, you know, we're enabling these people to continue to throw trash, and they'll get it Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays. That's what I'm concerned about.
Thank you. Board Member Casello, I am going to agree with you. Over in District 2, I'm just saying, at Sarah Sims Park, when we see them throwing things down, we tell them, saying, you know, why did you throw that down there? And the comments that they tell us is that they got people that's getting paid to do this, and it galls me, and I'm like you said, are we going to encourage them to just throw it down because we got people coming in now to clean up, you know, what they just don't want to put in the trash can? You know, I said all along that we need education, but maybe this might be a step in the right direction, but we need to have some kind of way to make people be accountable for what they're not doing. I agree with you.
Community service.
I just want to point out that these are on the major thoroughways through the city. When you want to make sure that people want to live here or have a business here, no. I don't think I don't want to say, putting blame on people is pointless if people don't want to live here or invest here. And if it doesn't look good, it makes it that much harder to get people to make those decisions. I think at some point it'll turn on its own and we won't have to do this. When you have enough investment and you have new development, new townhouses, South Federal doesn't need this. It's, if you go down South Federal, it's not that bad. So that's because they've had a lot of townhouse development down there, a lot of new development. So as that occurs, you're going to see a change anyway. This will change. So in the meantime, I think it behooves us as a city and CRA to get our house in order to invite people to come here. That's the point of it. It's not meant to be a permanent thing. It's not meant to take over for the city, because we're not. They're not. They don't have the money to pick up litter. They don't pick up litter. They pick up trash out of trash cans. That's all they can afford to do right now. So this is a supplement to get investment in this area, and that's our job. The CRA's job is to encourage investment in this area. And if it doesn't look good, the likelihood of that, it gets harder and harder. So this was approved at budget. We had a hard time getting, the city had a hard time getting anybody to give them pricing to do this. It's not a common, believe it or not, it's not a common, chore. Believe it or not, I guess I thought it was. But so I say it's like the policing that we're doing on MLK. Let's do it as a pilot program. Let's see what we get. Let's see if we get positive response. If people learn to live with cleanliness, they might like it. They might respect it. That is my thought. I don't know.
Just a couple of points. You say down south, because they got a lot of townhouses, I would think more people generate more trash, in my opinion. And we just talked, Mike talked just a couple of minutes earlier, maybe even expanding this to, if this doesn't work, maybe expand it to more days. So I don't see an end to this.
I do. You have a lot more home ownership in the south end of the city, or the federal. There's a different thing that's happened down there. You have Seaborn Cove. You have a lot of these major, larger things. It's, you know, they're behind gates and stuff like that. Okay. So
thank you. Was it Vice Chair McCray? Where there's always this much vacant land in the center of this, where at one time there was buildings and commercial places on MLK, there are residents. And was the trash that much of a problem then as it is now?
No, because really, I'm not trying to be funny. We didn't have that much to throw away because everything we had, we needed it.
And this is my hometown. This is my home area, and I walk this all the time. And there is two trash cans on MLK. There's a trash can at the corner of CVS, and there's also Bud's trash can. But that's it. We're talking, I don't know how many, we're over 2 miles or so. And there's about 4 or 5 convenience stores that we're talking about. And so this is a 3-month program or 4-month?
Well, we just got it going, but we can certainly.
Well, no. I just want to know. There is the
fiscal year.
Yeah,
it is. It's going to end soon. And so what the plan is that we can learn from this, in the sense is that if we do need to put trash cans or recyclings, we can have the vendor tell us where exactly their problems are. Is there any sort of report that the vendor is going to give us to let us know exactly how we can move better forward, so that we can say, hey, if you know the city needs to pick up its trash, they need to put a trash can here or a recycling here to make it better for the city. A lot of people are in these areas are just on the streets anyway, and if they don't see a trash can, why would they want to go 4 or 5 blocks to throw away? That doesn't make sense. And so this is where we're going to benefit the city by having the CRA clean up the slum and blighted areas. And so I'm definitely for this. And is there any other comments?
I have one other comment. You know, this is not only a problem that's prevalent in Boynton. I work in Broward County on 6th Boulevard. and they have people constantly walking up and down that boulevard all day long just picking up trash. I'm just saying it's something that, you know, we're not the only city that, you know, is plagued by this problem. It's all over. But I'm just saying perhaps if we start this and they see that we're going to start picking up and stuff like that, maybe the mindset will click and say, don't throw it down because, you know, hey, I don't know, but maybe they see if we're cleaning it up and keeping it clean. Maybe somebody said, you know, it's my job to help keep it clean. You know, pilot program, try it, see if it works. If it works, keep it up. Not then, let's just continue it.
Absolutely. Have some, because yeah, there are people that pick it up anyway that aren't paid, and they complain. It's like, why am I the one doing this? And, you know, if we can create some pride in the area, I'm really looking forward to going it.
Chair, is the intention, I guess I'll ask Vivian this question, is the intention for us to keep doing this? Or is it to just pilot it, fix it, hopefully we get these residents to acknowledge the problem and then stop?
I think, no, the intention is to do it until you get some change, till you get enough investment that there's a change where there you don't have to keep doing it, that there's a change in the community where the people who do that are maybe not living there anymore or, you know, or they just stop that behavior. We put 10 trash cans on MLK. I can't remember what year that was. I think there's two left. I don't know where they went.
I'm going to jump in. Where they went, they burn up too. I could tell you that. they wanted to get warm, okay. Like we wired the night, and they just set them on fire.
Wow. Okay.
So $50,000 being allocated for about 3 to 4 months.
Mm-mm. No, that was the budget line item. We won't spend $50,000 till the end of the
month. $800 a week until the end of the fiscal year. Right. If we had started October 1st, the anticipation was that you'd have, you know, enough money to get us through the fiscal year.
So we're allocating $50,000 for a year.
It's already been done, and now we're actually getting the program before you. It's formulated, and whatever balance is left over from the $800 a week for the next, I just roughly said, I guess, 4 months before October or the end of the fiscal year. You can decide during budget whether you want to continue the project or cancel the project at the end of the fiscal year. You certainly can cancel the project at any time for the next 4 months if you so desire.
What's our review process in terms of deciding whether we keep or ixnay this, whether we see that there's less trash or more businesses? What's the outcome overall thing that we're looking for?
I don't think you're going to see any major change in 4 months. When cities do a clean and safe program, Delray does a clean and safe program. Clean and safe is where it's a much more comprehensive program than this. They have officers on the street. They pressure clean the sidewalks downtown. They pick up trash. They have ambassadors, they call it. These are the guys that pick up stuff, and they wear vests. And this is sort of edging into that as downtown evolves and the city evolves. I don't think you ever stop maintaining your city. I don't think there's a stopping point of maintaining your city, particularly as your downtown grows. Remember, the more people you invite, the more, if you have a dinner party with 5 people, there's only so much to clean. When you have 20 people, there's more to clean. They are going to create a little bit of mess. Your customers, your people you invite to your downtown, they kind of leave a mess sometimes. So you always have, it'll morph. Maybe from the point of we're inviting you here, and now you're here, we're going to clean up after you.
So, last question. I just want to make sure
This is important.
Yeah, I want to make sure that I understand when we basically get this project off the ground and we go with it. For example, you mentioned that we had 10 trash cans a couple of years ago. Now they're down to 2. Are we going to re-implement the addition of trash cans and recycling bins in order to kind of offset the people cleaning but just having things just picked up?
And I believe in trash cans. I'm a big believer in trash cans.
The balance of some of that money, Christine, has already earmarked, you know, the idea of getting additional cans. Obviously, the more cans there are with the leftover money than the $800 a week, it's easier for the vendor to empty a trash can than to walk around plucking trash off the ground. And again, to piggyback on the clean and safe program, these are done all over the country. Certainly, it's not new to the CRA, business improvement districts, downtown development districts. The police officer program that we have is, if you would kind of look at it as twofold, you know, we have a police officer program and we have a little bit of a clean program going. These are really to offset city services. If the city services were enough in both cases to take care of the job, we wouldn't be having this discussion, and we probably wouldn't have a CRA district particularly focusing on that. The city would be maintaining that to the level at which the
commission, the public, want it to be maintained. But as CRA districts redevelop and the addition of residents and trash and crime and code enforcement and all the other things, back alleys, you know, you've got all kinds of food now in an area that didn't have food before, so you've got to empty trash every day or twice a day in some cases, like Two Georges, for instance. So the city services become drained of funding to increase the additional services that are needed or pay for them. So nationwide, they turn to agencies like the one you're now sitting as a your company now. It's being looked at to try to offset and to enhance those city services. Ideally, CRA dollars would be spent on redevelopment, but we're also charged with creating a place that redevelopment wants to be. So it's all of it together, but these are great issues for you to discuss, certainly.
Michael, one last question. What's going to be the benchmark to know if we're being successful with this program, and what's the timeline for that?
Well, they're being managed by the city, with the city department, Public Works. There will be regular review of their lines on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Pictures will be taken. Assessments will be done by city management staff. I will certainly be traveling that as well. We're not going to measure the amount of trash bags, although we could add that and say, I think we would. We would say that we've, on a monthly basis or weekly, we're dumping 16 or 17 extra tons of trash or whatever the mark might be in a number to provide you with that data. I think that has to happen. I would hope that you'll see once it gets going. I mean, Delray, we had two people in code enforcement. That's all they did was pick
Thank
up
you,
mattresses
Michael.
And other things. So,
we're good. Thank you. All right.
Here, one last comment in regards to the trash cans. When we had the 10 trash cans on MLK Boulevard, it did not make a difference. I want that to be stated because I lived there.
Staff
okay.
will not Thank disagree you. With you there.
So can I hear a motion?
So move.
I hear a second.
Second.
And this, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Nay.
All right. So we got 4-1. Motion passes. All right. Executive Director's report.
Okay. I always will include the advisory board packet in your backup, so you have that, so you can see what was discussed. I'll include that in the backup. The next item is new businesses. We always include this in the CRA district, so you can be aware if you want to frequent any of these new businesses. Maybe not the cremation one.
One shot.
But maybe Mr. Hot Tub, the hot tub guy. Maybe him. But there's seven new ones, which is a lot from last time. So that shows a good thing, you know. We have a lot of requests for space. The challenge is Las Ventanas is pretty pricey. And the other space is either unavailable for lease or for sale. Most of the space people see vacant, they think it's available, but it's not. These are property owners that are non-responsive to anything, so, but we are trying. We try to get them somewhere that we can find space for them. But we do have a lot of inquiries, a lot.
Let me make a final comment. Okay, in regards to cremation, although we all laugh, the going thing for the state of Florida is cremation, they are on the uprise now, so it's not something to laugh at. They're doing more cremations than burials.
Always good to know.
For planning purposes.
Any additional comments, discussion? All right, future agenda items.
For all your future agenda items.
All right, any discussion on any future agenda item?
I'll just make a statement real quick.
Yep.
I think tonight that, you know, we had two individuals speak with regards to the Riverwalk development, and I think that was a perfect microcosm of what the city of Boynton feels. There are factions that believe that some of this development is too much. There are factions that believe that there should be lots of development because the future of the city financially might hinge on some of these projects. Coming up here as a new commissioner, I want to make sure that everybody knows, whatever group that you belong to, whatever faction you belong to in terms of pro or anti-development, how much or how little, how high or how low, that it's my goal as a commissioner to find out as much information from as many people as possible, and I intend to do that with regards to any of these projects. So I said I have a meeting tomorrow with some of the leaders of some of the intercoastal groups, and I will go into that meeting just like I would go into a meeting with a developer or city staff or people who live on the western side of the city where I'd represent District 1 with my eyes and ears open and understanding that we're making decisions that represent the interests of a 70,000-plus resident city, and that we have to make sure that we take into account the views of many different people, because that's what the city is. So, you know, just to make kind of a final thought with regards to development, because it's been kind of weighing on me every one of these meetings, obviously, and many of the commission meetings are coming up with major development projects. I think it's important that everybody understands that, you know, in politics, whether it's the federal, state, or local level, nobody's going to get 100% of what they want. But the idea is to bridge the gap between different viewpoints and make sure that whatever we get is agreeable to as many people as possible. And that's what I plan to do with my decisions with regards to development up here, is to try to make sure that as many people are as happy as possible with future development in the city, because I think that's important, not just, again, for the growth of the city, for the fiscal solvency of the city, but for the people as well. We need to make sure that we're making decisions that take into account the views of many different people, not necessarily just one group on this side or that side of town. So I just kind of wanted to sum that up and say that I'm looking at these development projects with an open mind, as I know my fellow commissioners are and CRA members are as well, and that I think everybody, whether it's up here on the board or in the population, needs to be willing to understand that nobody's getting 100% of what they want, and hopefully you get something that you like, which is better for the community.
I hear a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Air conditioned.
All in favor.
Aye.
Aye.